it's an exciting time to be a young softball player, and I am a little bit jealous of the girls that I get to see out there. But for those who don't know who I am, I'm Aaron Weintraub. I'm a mental skills coach. I met Kevin in 2008 and first was scheduled to do a little mental training for his players on the gold team on June 18th. I know that because I didn't show up, because that's the day that my twins were born. And we rescheduled and have worked together ever since. I really enjoyed being a coach on that gold team, and somebody they got to see Kevin as Texas Glory grew into what it is today. I'm a big fan of Kevin. He's a hard worker. He's in it for the right reasons. And, you know, I appreciate that he has set us up to do these webinars to help you all work on your mental toughness skills. I also appreciate the culture that he sets with Glory, and the Glory Way fundamentals that we're going to go through tonight are the foundation for that. So we're going to get started right in with that, with the first one. I guess one note before we do, as a mental skills coach, my job is to help you be the best version of yourself a little bit more consistently. And nobody's perfect at that. But when you can learn to be a little bit more consistent, a little bit more mentally tough, you know, I certainly think you can have an edge over your opponents. And our goal within Glory, one of the many goals, is to have an average level of mental toughness that's above average. And so I'm excited to be a part of that. And I think these leadership fundamentals and the mental game fundamentals are really the foundation and core of a lot of really great information that you're going to enjoy. So what I have on the screen now is just a PowerPoint. And, you know, I like to start with this idea that sports psychology, which is what I teach, is simply the study of what successful athletes do. You don't have to be sick to get better. That's my Gmail email address. And it's also important for us to understand that sports psychology is not for people with a diagnosable psychological problem. It's for athletes that want to get better faster, be a good leader, make their teammates better, and deal with pressure effectively. The great thing about sports is that, you know, softball is going to tell the truth about how good you are. And that's not just, are you talented and do you work hard? Performance is not equal to such a simple formula as just talent and hard work. But your performance is how good you are. And that's a combination of physical skills and mental skills interacting. Physical skills are things like speed, strength, your genetics, and your mechanics. Mental skills is basically an umbrella term that means everything else that affects how good you're playing. So it's communication, it's strategy, but it's also things like focus and courage and attitude and self-talk. So a big part of this mental skills training stuff is to help you learn how to coach yourself and practice these mental skills while you're practicing physically. Now, if you ask any Major League Baseball player how important is the mental side of the game, they're going to tell you a number that's 80% or higher. If you go to the younger ages, the 10 years and the 12 years, I don't think it's as important, but obviously I'm a fan of the mental side of the game. You're here, so you know, I think I may be preaching to the choir, but I've created a poll, and I want you to find your way over there at some point tonight and just vote for how important the mental side of the game is for you at this age and with the goals that you have. And then think about how much time do you spend, how much of your training is dedicated to improving your mental skills. And hopefully by the end of tonight, you have more clarity. I've succeeded in demystifying, because it doesn't need to be tricky. You have clarity on how to practice your mental toughness while you're practicing physically, and sometimes even when you're not. Okay, so let's jump right in with these Glory fundamentals. And remember, you can chat with me at any time. I may or may not be looking at the chat right when you send it. So if you're having any trouble hearing me, or if you have a question or a comment, please just go over to the chat and jump in there. Catch my attention with all caps or whatever you want to do. Okay, so glory fundamental of leadership, number one, leave the world a little bit better than how you found it. That was not a new concept when I came to glory. And I wouldn't have certainly argued if someone said that's a good idea. But I didn't really appreciate this leadership fundamental until I heard Kevin talk about it just about every time I saw him at the Diamond. He didn't only talk about it, he modeled it by picking up a piece of trash, by coaching and being optimistic, and just by being Kevin. But let's think about this. How do we leave the world a little bit better than how we found it when we're talking specifically about softball? Well, you see, I'm a speaker for Positive Coaching Alliance, and well, that didn't work. It went back to that screen. Let's leave it on the roots. And we talk about honoring the game. And I think this is a good example for on-field strategies for leaving the world a little bit better than how we found it. We want to respect the roots of the game. And roots is an acronym that stands for rules. We want to respect the rules not only so that we don't get caught, but so that we can take advantage of knowing the rules, like when the play starts and ends, and so that we follow them and their intent. We look for an edge wherever we can find it without breaking the intent of the rule book. We don't want to cheat. We want to earn the victory. We want to respect the opponents. The worst way to win a softball game is by forfeit. And the opponents are there to help us identify what's working and what's not working. I hope we make learning more important than our stats today, and certainly our opponents are an asset in the process of finding out how good we can be at softball. So I hope that handshake at the end of the game is not just something you do out of habit, but something where you show respect for their effort and appreciation for the opponents. We want to respect the officials. The umpires will make mistakes, and when an umpire misses a call and it goes against your team, I hope you remember to view that as a good thing. It is a bad thing because it doesn't help you win the game. I get that. But things are not only bad, they're good. They're not only good or bad, they can be good and bad. And this is a great example. If we want to practice being mentally tough, the best time to practice that is when life's not fair. So the next time the official misses a call, maybe you'll say, "Thank you, Mr. Umpire, for letting me practice my resilience and my mental toughness and controlling what I can control." Now, you can laugh at this point because that's so far from normal. But look, officials are there because they love the game. They love the girls. They're going to make mistakes. And when they do, control what you can control. And remember to respect that official, even though he or she just made a mistake. We want to respect teammates. They're not always going to do what we like. But they all bring strengths and weaknesses to the team. And if they're doing their best, man, they're helping us out. We'll talk more about that as we get into leadership, but certainly we want to respect everybody. You don't have to be best friends, but you do have to respect your teammates if you're going to have great chemistry. And finally, we want to respect yourself. Look, softball is a game of, quote, failure. You're going to get outs. You're going to boot balls. You're going to make mistakes. You're going to have times when it's tempting to act like it's, you don't care. When you respect yourself and you live with integrity, you follow your own values, good things are going to happen, especially if you have patience and faith. So certainly don't forget to respect yourself. Leave the world a little bit better than how you found it, on the field and off, and then softball is definitely making the world a better place. Okay, so leadership fundamental number two, vision. Kevin has a vision where every glory team, and I've visited with him a lot about this, has within that team a culture, a way we do things here that emphasizes excellence. We do common things in an uncommon way. Enthusiasm, we do them with positive energy. Hey, I won the lottery when I was born because I get to play softball for glory. That's pretty cool. Now, you may not have thought you won the lottery when you were born, when you're 11 years old, but I really think you did. If you think about it, not literally, but are you rich? Do you have the health and the wealth and the freedom to get to play ball with your friends, a game, to find out how good you can be? What a great luxury. The reality is, if you'd have been born any time in any place in the history of the world, you probably would not be able to play softball with your friends as much as you do. We're lucky. And when we start with an attitude of gratitude, it's very easy to maintain enthusiasm, even through the struggles of softball and getting outside of your comfort zone and making mistakes. Now, when you make that mistake, if you don't have forgiveness, it's going to be hard to maintain that positive attitude. If you don't have that positive attitude, your rate of learning and your level of performance, your excellence is going to go down. It doesn't surprise people that I think excellence and enthusiasm are important, but the fact that I put forgiveness right up there with those two does surprise some people. Remember, everybody makes mistakes. So forgive so you can forget. Then you can maintain your enthusiasm and your excellence. We do all these things with teamwork. Sometimes it's a lot easier to forgive and forget when our teammates are positive. And we do it all while we're competing with each other, with other teams, and most of all, we're competing with ourselves. Am I better today than I was yesterday? I hope that's a big part of the question that you're asking after each practice and after each game. Did I get better today? What can I learn from today's experiences? Because experience doesn't make you better. It's what you do with it. And if you are mindful of what works, and you're mindful, meaning you notice what doesn't work, not emotionally, that's judgment. The difference between judgment and mindfulness is simply take the emotion out of it. If it worked, good, I'm going to do it again. If it didn't work, also good, I'm going to change something. Be mindful of what works and what doesn't work. Compete with yourself to get better than you used to be. And enjoy competing with others as well for playing time and for victories. So, 5 details of the way we want to do things here: excellence, enthusiasm, forgiveness, teamwork, and competitiveness. Okay. Now, fundamental number 3, lead by example, bench the ego and give your best effort now. Man, is that easy to say and hard to do. Sure, we have to get rid of whining. We have to get rid of complaining and excuses. And we want to lead by example. Because when we talk about leadership fundamentals, we're not just talking about the pitcher or the oldest player on the team or the tallest player or the best player or the third hitter in the lineup. We're talking about leadership by everyone. We want everyone to be a leader by giving their best effort now. That is so easy to say and so hard to do. That is, in its essence, what mental toughness is. Give your best effort on one pitch, one drill, whatever is happening now. Accept what happens as what happens, because reality is not going to change. There's going to be setbacks. And then repeat. What does it take to give your best effort now? That's a really good question. And we're going to explore how to control the controllables. One of the things that I want to happen as a result of mental skills training is for you to have clarity on what are you responsible for? You're not responsible for winning the game or getting an out on defense. You're responsible for maximizing your team's chances for getting outs, winning games, scoring runs, controlling the controllables. Right now, I want to look at a video that is a pregame motivational speech from the movie We Are Marshall. And then after that video plays, we'll talk about that a little bit. Here it is.
I want to talk about our opponent this afternoon. They're bigger, faster, stronger, more experienced, and on paper, they're just better. And they know it, too. But I want to tell you something that they don't know. They don't know your heart. I do. I've seen it. You have shown it to me. You have shown this coaching staff, your teammates, you have shown yourselves just exactly who you are in here. When you take that field today, you've got to lay that heart on the line, man. From the soles of your feet, with every ounce of blood you've got in your body, lay it on the line until the final whistle blows. And if you do that, we cannot lose. We may be behind on the scoreboard at the end of the game, but if you play like that, we cannot be defeated.
So, we cannot be defeated. That works for Hollywood. But in the real world, if you're behind on the scoreboard, doesn't that mean you were just defeated? You see, that's a really easy thing to believe. But ultimately, I think Hollywood got it right. We may not have a crescendo in the music in our pregame speeches in the real world like they do in Hollywood. But if we can learn to have a perspective on success that says, if you give your best effort right now, accept whatever happens, and then repeat it again on the next pitch, and in this view, everyone can be a winner. So yes, I think in this case, Hollywood got it right. We'll talk more about giving your best effort now as we go through the mental game fundamentals. Right now, let's go on to leadership fundamental number 4, connect with empathy. Don't get mad, get curious. Easy to say, hard to do. There's going to be times when you don't like your teammates. And if you think of what may be the greatest sports movie of all time, Remember the Titans, and you may not have even seen it yet. I encourage you to go watch it. This was at a time when racial tensions were high and the whites and the blacks were forced to play together with a black head coach, and they were suffering together in training camp doing their running. They were even rooming together, but they were like that top picture. They were not getting along. And the coach knew he had a problem. There was not respect among teammates. He knew he had to get them to connect with each other. If you want to be a great leader, yes, vision. Where are we headed? How are we going to get there? Yes, lead by example, because no one wants to follow someone who talks the talk but doesn't walk the talk. But the next step is to connect with your teammates. It's not, I'm so good, follow me. It's, hey, let's go do this together. And the way they turned it around in that movie is the coach said, you got to go back to your room and you got to ask him what his favorite food is, ask him what his dad does, ask him what he wants to be when he gets older, ask him what his biggest fears are. And they started to realize, hey, he may have different color skin than me, but he's not so much different than I am. And they started to connect with each other. Spend time with your teammates. Be forgiving when they do something you don't like. Don't get mad. Get curious. Now, that may sound pretty good, but if you'll bear with me just a moment, I've got another video that just does an amazing job of really explaining what empathy is all about.
So what is empathy, and why is it very different than sympathy? Empathy fuels connection. Sympathy drives disconnection. Empathy, it's very interesting. Teresa Wiseman is a nursing scholar who studied professions, very diverse professions where empathy is relevant, and came up with 4 qualities of empathy. Perspective taking, the ability to take the perspective of another person or recognize their perspective as their truth. Staying out of judgment, not easy when you enjoy it as much as most of us do. Recognizing emotion in other people and then communicating that. Empathy is feeling with people. And to me, I always think of empathy as this kind of sacred space when someone's kind of in a deep hole and they shout out from the bottom and they say, I'm stuck, it's dark, I'm overwhelmed. And then we look and we say, hey, you can climb down. I know what it's like down here. And you're not alone. Sympathy is, ooh, it's bad, uh-huh. No, you want a sandwich? Empathy is a choice, and it's a vulnerable choice, because in order to connect with you, I have to connect with something in myself that knows that feeling. Rarely, if ever, does an empathic response begin with "at least." And we do it all the time. Because you know what? Someone just shared something with us that's incredibly painful, and we're trying to silver lining it. I don't think that's a verb, but I'm using it as one. We're trying to put the silver lining around it. So, I had a miscarriage. Oh, at least you know you can get pregnant. I think my marriage is falling apart. At least you have a marriage. John's getting kicked out of school. At least Sarah is an A student. But one of the things we do sometimes in the face of very difficult conversations is we try to make things better. If I share something with you that's very difficult, I'd rather you say, "I don't even know what to say right now. I'm just so glad you told me." Because the truth is, rarely can a response make something better. What makes something better is connection.
I just think that video does such a better job than I can do of defining empathy and helping us understand, what it means to really connect with our teammates. And there are times when we want to put the silver lining, and certainly a big part of positive self-talk is understanding why the challenges are good for us. But there are also times when it's just most important to be a good listener and to be a great teammate that way. Okay, leadership fundamental number 5. It takes courage, the strength of will to do what's difficult, to get rid of both complacency and a person's safety net. It's a big sentence, man. Complacency, it's just easier to do nothing than something. It takes courage to put yourself out there. You're risking injury. You're risking embarrassment. You're risking, what if my genetics aren't as good as I would like? Well, first of all, you'll never know that if you don't do your best. But second of all, if that's the case and you do your best, man, you're going to be rewarded in so many ways. And in my view and in many other people's view, you are a winner. It may not happen for you on the field. I don't know. You certainly increase your chances when you give your best. It is hard to get rid of that safety net. It is so much easier to just do what comes easy. But if you're willing to get outside of your comfort zone, outside of your familiar zone, and give your best effort now to do what's difficult, then you're going to get rewarded, often in the way that you're hoping for. It takes a ton of courage to give your best effort right now to make yourself and to make your teammates better. You may be trying to be a great leader, and you may think by saying something that it will help, and your teammates may not respond the way you wanted them to. If you thought it was a good idea, do it. The way to become a great leader is to lead. You got to take action. If it doesn't work, certainly you want to change it next time. You want to become faster? Run sprints. You want to throw the ball harder? Long toss. Throw the ball hard. You want to be a great leader? Lead. And that means you're going to make mistakes. It takes courage to put yourself out there, risk criticism, to know that you make mistakes, but it's still okay to try to help others. It's a lot easier to get rid of that safety net when you understand that your best effort is always good enough, when you define success in controllable ways. Maya Angelou is a great American. She basically paraphrased this quote from Winston Churchill, and I have no doubt that Winston Churchill got it from somebody else. But this is what she says about courage, because I talk about the holy grails of mental training being self-talk, attitude, and focus, and those are important, but they're not as important as courage, because courage is the most important of all the virtues. Without courage, you can't practice anything else, any other virtue consistently. You can practice it erratically, but you won't be consistent without courage. Do you have the toughness, the courage, the strength of will to do what's difficult in giving your best effort now, accepting whatever happens, and then doing it again? I hope so. because I get to watch you play for glory. And that's going to be fun to see what happens. In this idea of giving your best effort, it's not just about trying hard. I've created an entire diagram here of what does it take to give your best effort on one pitch. There's your approach. And in softball, that means before the action happens. You're thinking, you're being a coach. You're getting your mind, your body, your strategy ready to go. That's here. Create an ideal state with getting your mind and your body ready. Then it's here. Commit to a plan of attack. What do I want to do on this next pitch? When you're 10 years old and you're hitting, you want to swing at the strikes and not swing at the balls. When you're 18 years old, it's a lot more complicated than that. Define what do I want to do on this pitch? And then become an athlete. Don't be a coach anymore. Over here, this is coaching to get your mind, your body, and your strategy ready. Over here, this is being an athlete, perform, doing it. There's lots of ways to say it. Trust your stuff. See it big. Let it happen. The point here is that you're focused and you're just doing it. If you give your best effort to do all of those details, I don't know what else you can control. I think you are a winner. I think it's that simple, but it's hard to do. Easy to say, hard to do. Give your best effort now. Okay. Number six, good values attract good people, and good people make me better. Ubuntu is from an African tribe. It means I can't be all I can be unless you are being all you can be. For me to be the best version of myself, I need you. Humans are social. We work better with others. We want everyone to be a leader. If I'm giving my best effort and you're giving your best effort, our efforts are going to be better. At Positive Coaching Alliance, we have a great analogy where we talk about an emotional fuel tank. If my tank is full, then I'm going to be more coachable. I'm going to deal with pressure better. I'm going to learn faster. I'm going to have more fun. I'm going to be more confident. So what fills this emotional fuel tank that allows me to get farther in softball and in life? Well, truthful and specific praise. Coaches are supposed to criticize and correct, but we want them to do that less than they give truthful and specific praise. That's a hard thing to do. And so teammates can help with that by letting the coaches do the correction and almost entirely reinforce the positives. Every once in a while, a leader may provide some criticism or correction, but usually that's the coach's job. Sarcasm, look, there's exceptions to every rule, but sarcasm usually drains the tank, as do nonverbals like bad body language and ignoring people when they're talking. We want to be good listeners. We want to have positive body language. Get big, have fun, smile, express appreciation, and focus on solutions with a growth mindset. Some of you are taught a growth mindset in school, and you've never thought about having a growth mindset on the softball diamond. We want to focus on solutions and achievements and be mindful, not judgmental. That sounds like a growth mindset. The reality is, when we have this sort of teamwork, and that's a great acronym, together, everyone achieves more. We're going to have more fun. We're going to magnify each other's strengths, and we're going to cover each other's weaknesses in the games. We're going to get better faster, and we're going to deal with pressure. We're going to nip problems in the bud so that we can focus on the softball. There's always going to be some drama with girls playing, spending a lot of time together. But because of that respect and because of that leadership by everyone, together, everyone can achieve more. And win. Win is fun, right? Okay. Leadership fundamental number seven, as I check the chat to see if there's anything I need to be aware of. Keep chatting at me if you've got any questions. I know I talk a lot. It's kind of the nature of the beast here with the webinar. Little things make the big things happen. I want to go back to that culture of excellence. and I want to tell you a story about a coach named John Wooden. Bill Walton tells this story most famously. He's a Hall of Fame NBA player now and a broadcaster, but he stuttered in college. And when he was a first-year player at UCLA, he was a big-time recruit, and they had won a national championship the year before. And he tells a story about how he went to the first team meeting and he wanted to know what sage advice the old coach, Coach Wooden, was going to give them that got the ball rolling towards another national championship. Well, what he got was how to put on two pairs of socks lined up just correctly and then lace his shoes. And Walton thought, man, I wanted sage advice and you're giving me socks and shoes? Old coach must be crazy. Maybe the assistant coaches are the sage, wise ones around here. But it turns out, big guys running up and down a basketball court 2 hours a day for the next 6 months, if they don't put on their socks and shoes the right way, they're more likely to get a blister. If they get a blister, well, now they can't run at full speed. If they can't run at full speed, then they're not making their teammates as good as they can. Umbutu, I need you to be at your best so that I can be at my best. It turns out that the sage advice Walton was looking for is that excellence is to do common things in an uncommon way. Non-glory teams are going to stretch and throw and catch. But when they throw the ball, do they remember to look at a small target, aim small, miss small? Do they remember to be positive through an error? Little things make the big things happen. And if we're focused on the details, that's a good time to think about mechanics. If they're focused on the details of the mechanics and the strategy and the mental game of positive self-talk and getting better faster and making our teammates better, the big things are going to happen. That was the sage advice. Excellence is to do common things in an uncommon way. We do things right. One more example. If you're running through first base, pay attention to that word through, not to. If you're running 20 yards or 50 yards, the coach could always just move back and say, run farther. We do things right means we're going to do it the best we can. If I were to ask you, did you run all the way through the line? And you were to say yes, then congratulations. You were paying attention to detail and doing things with excellence. If you were to say no, then obviously there's an adjustment to be made. The question is, did you run as fast as you can through the line? If your answer is maybe, one, you're normal. Two, that's not the glory way. Our goal is not to be normal. Normal is often an excuse to act without courage, to not do what's difficult. If you pay attention to the details of running through the line, then you won't say, I think I did. You'll say, I know I did. We do things right. Leadership fundamental number 8. Greatness and success are attainable by all. Wait a second, in softball, doesn't somebody have to lose? Can everyone be great? What if my genetics only lead me to be 5'4" tall? Well, then maybe you're the pitcher at Ole Miss who threw every pitch for her team in the SEC tournament last year, which they won for the first time in school history, beating Florida, beating Alabama, and beating LSU. Greatness and success are attainable by all. I'll tell you more about her later because I got the pleasure of going to Ole Miss just a couple weeks ago. But I really do think that we can have a perspective on success that's uncommon, true, and useful for winning more softball games. And this perspective on success doesn't come from me. It comes from John Wooden, that basketball coach from UCLA, John Wooden, talking about success. Unfortunately, he died about 5 or 6 years ago when he was 99. He lived a great life. Here he is.
I coined my own definition of success in 1934 when I was teaching at a high school in South Bend, Indiana, being a little bit disappointed and disillusioned, perhaps And I knew how Mr. Webster defined it as the accumulation of material possessions or the attainment of a position of power or prestige or something of that sort. Worthy accomplishments, perhaps, but in my opinion, not necessarily indicative of success. And I recalled I was raised on a small farm in southern Indiana, and Dad tried to teach me and my brothers that you should never try to be better than someone else, always learn from others, and never cease trying to be the best you could be. That's under your control. And if you get too engrossed and involved and concerned in regard to the things over which you have no control, it will adversely affect the things over which you have control. Then I ran across a simple verse that said, "At God's footstool to confess, a poor soul knelt and bowed his head. I failed," he cried. "The master said, thou didst thy best." That is success. From those things, I coined my own definition of success, which is peace of mind attained only through self-satisfaction in knowing you made the effort to do the best of which you're capable.
So there he is. Now, I'm checking chat sometimes, but I'm also putting my phone number if you need to text me. Just making sure this webinar is working the way it's supposed to be. So if you need to text me at any time, just let me know. Now, this idea that success is attainable by all, man, that's good news because everyone can do it. But it might be bad news because it's pretty hard. And John Wooden himself, he does a great job of talking about the building blocks of what does it take to be successful. And there it is, his pyramid of success with the foundation of enthusiasm. We talked about that already. Industriousness, which simply means hard and smart work. And then working well with others in the base here, friendship, loyalty, and cooperation. Moving up to the next level, he talks about self-control. He talks about being alert, paying attention, having initiative, taking action. He talks about working with a purpose, with intentness. Moving up to the next level, the building block of team spirit, skill, conditioning. Getting really high up the pyramid, another building block is poise, which he defines as just be yourself. Don't try to do more than what you can do. Just be poised. Just be yourself. What a great definition. Having confidence built on the foundation of hard work. Having competitive greatness, rising to the occasion when the lights are on and enjoying the view from that mountaintop. And he talks about patience and faith. We'll get to that. His pyramid of success is just a great lesson for all of us to study and get to know more about how to be successful, how to give our best effort one step at a time. Glory Way, leadership fundamental number 9, the carrot is mightier than the stick and half full is greater than half empty. Now, this is talking about perspective, and perspective is the ability to see things accurately. It can also be defined as a specific point of view and understanding things or events. Look, two people can look at the same thing and see a 6 or a 9. Which is correct? Really depends on how you look at it. And it's often easier to see the picture when you're not inside the frame. I know we've got some parents watching. I have 5 kids myself. I think parenting is the toughest job in the world. We're going to make mistakes. We're supposed to be biased because it's our baby out there. One of the great things about Glory, when the culture is done right, and I know we're trying, hopefully we're getting 100% of teams on board, is that it is a safe place physically and emotionally to release your daughter. So let her be her on the team. And remember that many kids report that their least favorite part of their youth sports experience is the ride home with mom and dad. I'm not saying you shouldn't coach them, and certainly you should teach those life lessons that they can learn through softball. But try to leave the winning up to the players and the coaches and just focus on teaching, reinforcing those life lessons. Okay, back to perspective. Is it really 3 or is it 4? I don't know. Again, it depends on how you look at it. That's weird, isn't it? The reality is our history really affects our perspective, how we view things. If you've been stuck on land, you're excited for a boat. If you've been stuck on a boat, you're excited for land. We all have different histories. When we become good listeners, we get curious instead of mad. We have empathy. We connect better with people. We become better listeners. Everybody's got a different perspective. We can get closer to understanding people by talking to them. So this idea that the carrot is mightier than the stick doesn't mean that the stick doesn't have any power. It does. Negative motivation can be very useful, but ultimately we don't believe it can be as powerful as positive motivation. And the reality is we get to play softball and pursue the question, how good can I be at this game? Look, perspective is a big deal. You can learn to look at the same thing in a new way, the same old thing. Sorry, I messed that one up, but hey, nobody's perfect, so I'll take my imaginary grass and throw it away. Okay, this FedEx logo, you've seen it before. Have you ever seen the arrow that's between the E and the X? Look for it. It's in what we call negative space. And if you've never seen it before today, here's my challenge for you. I challenge you not to see it the next time that truck is on the road. We can learn to look at the same old situation. The umpire missing a call and it goes against us. Of course it's bad, but we can learn to view it as good. We can learn to view the glass not as half empty, but as half full. Some people in their genetics, their psychology, they may be predisposed to negative thinking, but that doesn't mean they're stuck there. We'll talk more about this in future webinars, but the reality is if you can identify a habit that's not helping you, you can change it. It takes courage to do both, but we're very powerful. And what better life skill than to practice viewing the glass as half full rather than half empty? I've got so many more stories about that. We've got to go on tonight. So I hope you'll attend the next webinar and we'll continue down that path. Glory Way, leadership fundamental number 10. Adversity is good for me as long as I literally survive. I'm not going to whine, complain, or make excuses. Instead, I'm going to recognize that I can drive to Canada at night as long as I got headlights, because all I need to be able to see is the next 200 feet. It's just about executing one pitch. Can I give my best effort on the only pitch that matters, the next one? Well, to do that, I'm going to have to get my mind and my body ready to go. I'm going to have to commit to what do I want to do on this pitch. And then I'm going to have to step into sacred space and let it happen. Focus. Remember that the journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step. And remember that if it doesn't kill you, it's good for you. I mean that literally. Change bad or good to bad and good. Also, change good to good and bad. If you hit a home run, that's absolutely good. I'm not saying it's not. But it can be bad if you think you've arrived, if you think you don't need to get better, if you think you can now just do what you've always done. The bad stuff is also good. I'm not saying it's not bad. And it's not bad to think that it's bad. It's bad to stay stuck in thinking that it's bad. So remember to look for a new perspective. Why is it also good? Patience and faith. Did I skip one? No. Okay. Number 11, patience and faith hold it all together. And I get that from John Wooden, because that's what he taught. Have patience. You may be working hard and not seeing the results. That doesn't mean you're not getting better. It'll click at some point and you may seem to take a leap in performance, but the reality is learning has been happening because of your hard work. Have faith. In the short run, life's not fair, but have faith that in the long run, good behavior will be rewarded. He puts patience and faith right up there at the top, but he talks about it. It's really the glue that holds all the blocks in place. Patience and faith running throughout the challenge of giving your best effort now, the challenge of being successful. Number 12, it's another quote from that guy, John Wooden, who knew a lot about leadership. You know, one of the ways I knew he knew a lot about leadership? Well, I'll give you two ways. One, he was asked after they won a national championship, "Coach, was this a successful season?" And his answer was, "I don't know yet. You'll have to ask me again in 15 years. What he meant by that is, I know we won on the scoreboard, and I know that's how a lot of people think of success. But for me to really feel like it's successful, I need these guys that I was charged with being a mentor for. I need them to go out, and over the next 15 years, I need them to make the world a better place." Another way I know that what he taught worked is because his teams won. 10 national championships in 12 years, 7 in a row, 88 straight games. They won. What he taught clearly worked. It's easy to say, try to be perfect. It's easy to fall into the trap, especially if you're a perfectionist who beats themselves up over every little mistake, which many girls are. It's easy to say this, but it's hard to do it. Remember, nobody's perfect. Strive for perfection, but never expect it. That's the forgiveness piece. That's a part of the Glory Way culture. It allows us to maintain our enthusiasm after a mistake. Try to be perfect, but don't expect it. Only God is perfect. Okay, humans make mistakes. Remember that? Now, we're going to shift gears a little bit, although this is all connected, and go through these mental game. I've kind of touched on a lot of them, so it'll actually be easy for me to finish on time. We've got 12 mental game fundamentals and 12 minutes left, and we're going to finish on time. I appreciate y'all being there. I'm going to check the chat right now. If you've got anything, let me know. I see somebody stopped, but I think we're still running strong on the air. Okay. Mental game fundamental number one. Softball is what we do. It's not who we are. That's important. That's why it's number one. Don't ever forget that softball is a vehicle to learn how to be good at life, to learn how to have fun by winning softball games. But even though we spend a lot of time at it, it does not define us. It's just a game. Softball is what we do. It is not who we are. Success is the peace of mind that comes from knowing you did your best, the John Wooden definition. The Glory Way is all about giving your best effort now. Your best effort is always good enough. It's all you can do. Number three, play to win. Don't play not to lose. Play to win. Be aggressive. Communicate with yourself and others in a positive manner. I mean this very literally, in the way you talk to yourself and the way you talk to others. Have you ever gone up to the batter's box and said, "Don't strike out"? You're playing not to lose. In math, -1 times -1 is 1. A double negative is a positive. But in softball, that's not the case. Don't play not to lose. Don't tell yourself, "Don't mess up." Tell yourself, "Play to win." Be aggressive. Make aggressive mistakes. Get outside of your comfort zone. Go for the extra base. Find out what works and what doesn't work. Communicate to yourself and others in a positive manner. Instead of, "Don't make a bad throw," make a good throw. Instead of, "Don't walk this girl," strike her out. Instead of, "Don't hang the changeup high in the zone," good low changeup. Play to win. Be aggressive and talk to yourself and others in a positive manner. Now, I've come up with this list of, quote, bad words, curse words. We're not going to go into a ton of detail tonight, but this is posted on my website, coachtraub.com. I'm happy to send it to anybody. Same thing with that diagram for how to give your best effort on one pitch. I'm happy to share these resources with anyone. But some of this negative thinking that can even happen subconsciously until we pay attention to it, like, "Can't You've heard that one before. If I believe I can't, I'll be right. If I believe I can, at least I might. So we want to leave the door open. Can't is a bad word. It's negative. I'm not is a sneaky version of a can't. Like, I'm not fast. It's a sneaky version of I can't run fast. I thought that was true when I was 12. Turns out, I just didn't have very good form and very good strength. Get away from I'm not or I can't. There are exceptions to these rules. And you can study these with Elite Athlete Audio number 16. I'll mention that in a couple minutes. But these should and supposed to. Just say I could or I want to. You don't have to apologize if you make a mistake. Everybody makes a mistake. Just do your best. Don't call it a failure when you stumble. See it as a stepping stone to finding out how good you can be. Get away from negative words like I stink or I suck. It's okay to say I stunk on that one pitch because you're just reporting the facts. Maybe you did stink it up on that one. That doesn't mean you stink. Certainly don't call it a slump. Call it overdue. They report the same past, but are much more optimistic and aggressive about a good future. Try to get away from worrying and just do your best now. You don't have to worry because your best effort is always good enough. Fundamental number 4, more communication is nonverbal than verbal. Act poised and upbeat. Carry yourself in a big manner. Act the way you respect in others. If a Hollywood actor puts themselves in character, they have to think and have body language in a certain way. Be tough with your thoughts. Be tough with your body language. I don't believe in fake it till you make it, because then I think you're trying to lie to yourself, and that's not going to work. But I absolutely believe in act as if you already are the way you want to be. You might be surprised at how quickly you can change your state by thinking good thoughts and having good body language. Number 5, the most important game, the most important pitch or drill is the next one. Know when the play starts and finishes. For example, if you hit a ground ball to shortstop, this is the example that Kevin always uses, and I've seen him teach this so many times. When you run through first base and you look to your right for an overthrow, then turn around and walk slowly back to first base and look to the middle infielders. Because if you know when the play ends, which is not when the ball is in the circle, it's when the ball is in the circle and you're touching first base. Maybe you can get the next base, which is the only one that matters now that you've already got first base. Every base runner's objective is the next base. Again, be aggressive. The whole point of mental skills training is to help you coach yourself, and you got to live with yourself for the whole rest of your life. I love the poem, The Man in the Glass. That's on my website. Maybe I'll share it with you in a future webinar. I hope you come back. Number 7 is that the most important coach you'll ever have is yourself. Coaches, parents, they're teaching players how to be good at life, which happily includes softball. Number 8, you are responsible for your behavior. No whining, no excuses, don't complain. You can control, are you ready in your mind, your attitude? You can control, are you ready in your body, your physiology? You can control, what do I want to do on this pitch? And then you can switch from a coaching mode into this sacred space where you're going to be an athlete. You're engaged with the pitcher's rubber. You're inside the batter's box with 2 feet. Now you can learn to control your focus. You can learn to block out distractions. We'll go into a lot more detail on that one in the near future, with how to block out distractions. But forgiveness is a huge piece there. Control the controllables and give your best effort one pitch at a time. There are those steps. How do you control your attitude? It's with your thoughts. What are you focused on? What are you thinking about? How are you talking to yourself? How do you control your physiology? Your body language, your breathing. You're so powerful when you learn to control your thoughts and your body language and tap into the power of a deep breath. Commit to a plan of attack. What can I control on this play? Get specific What do I want to do? And then see it and do it. I'm coming down the home stretch at number 9. Every player has those two roles of being a coach and then an athlete. That sacred space where you don't want to think is what I call the circle of focus for the fielders, engaged with the rubber, ready to lead off the base. It's a timing thing more than anything. And the pitcher is the one who gets to set that timing. Don't forfeit that advantage, pitchers. Don't engage the rubber until you're ready to do so. Number 10, we want you to develop routines to get really good at this. Your routine is designed to get you into the right place at the right time. And it's not giving your best effort to just do what you've always done. What can I do to get better at controlling these controllable aspects of learning and performance? Your routine can help you do that, and everybody's routine is going to be different. We'll go into a lot more detail there, trust me. When in sacred space, keep it simple and just lock in on something outside of your body. Laser focus on the task at hand. See the ball, hitters. See the target, the glove, or whatever your target is, pitchers, and let it happen. That narrow external focus, that's where you want your head to be when it's time to be an athlete. That is easy to say, hard to do. So we want to practice it at practice. That's how we do things here. We practice that game mentality of just laser focus on the task at hand. Sometimes that's broader, but when you're in that sacred space as a hitter, it's just the release point. You can't see my hand down there as a pitcher, but you just want to see the ball big. And number 12, your best effort is tough to give, but if you're disciplined enough to design a plan, create an ideal state, and commit all the stuff I've been talking about. If you design a routine and then hold yourself accountable for doing what you think is a good idea, that's all you can do. And you're successful even before you see what happens. That is so hard to buy into. I'm trying to convince you that your best effort is always good enough. B equals age stands for your best effort is always good enough. That is all you can do. Think about that. You don't have to wait to see if you win the game or if you win this battle of this at bat to be successful, because you're doing everything you know to do at this point in your life. Remember, we want to maximize our team with leadership from everybody. I am what I am because of my teammates doing their best. Do you have the courage to give more? To do more than what most other people are doing? Most other people are just practicing physically. Can you practice physically and mentally? Do you have the courage to define success as just doing your best one step at a time? There's some reminders down there for coaches. Remember, you can either find a way or you can find an excuse, but you can't do both. And if you can repeat over and over, I'll just do my best now, then you are well on your way. That brings me to my last thing, which is I want to be a resource to you. You can go to my websites, coachtraub.com, my blog, where there's a lot of free information, or you can even buy stuff. It's softballmentalmaster.com. I didn't even put that on there. I probably should have. But my products are at softballmentalmaster.com. But I'm a glory coach, and so you can email me. You can call me on the phone. If you want to talk for several hours, you can hire me for that. But if you want to talk for several minutes, call me on the phone and ask a question. I'll be thrilled that you did. The last thing takes 30 seconds, so give me your best effort now. You've been a great audience already, I think. The webinar format is a little bit weird. But what I really want you now is to get this last 30 seconds of information, because it's the most important stuff. And that is the truth, that you are capable of making outstanding achievements your reality, including an ideal focus on the task at hand right now, one step at a time. Realities like staying positive through adversity, even if you're a perfectionist by nature. And realities like finding out how good can you be at softball. These are not easy goals. They won't be achieved overnight. But if you remember to have fun because you won the lottery when you were born, trust your stuff because you're powerful when you think good thoughts and have good body language. And take it one step at a time because that's all you can ever do in life. If you remember all that, you are well on your way. Thank you very much for attending tonight. Please tell your friends and come back in 2 weeks at the same time.